Tishri I was the date in the Old Testament when you inaugurate the reign of your next king. Tishri I was also thought to be the birth date of Noah. So Jesus, the Messiah, is the new Noah. Okay, you're starting to see how Genesis 6 sort of creeps into the picture here. What was significant about Noah? Noah's survival, Noah's presence on the earth post-flood, signaled, you know, it was supposed to signal the end of the watchers, the end of all this wickedness, the end of all this garbage, okay? There are passages that refer, in, again, Dead Sea Scroll text, to the chronology of the flood, okay, to, you know, some of this astronomical stuff going on. Specifically, they link it to the constellation of Orion, which in Aramaic is the constellation of Nephilah. Okay, it's the giant, because Orion was a giant. I mean, you have this concatenation of thoughts that, again, to a literate Jew, if they had read John, or, you know, John, Revelation is the last book of the New Testament, so John got this information from somewhere, maybe Mary, maybe the disciple, who knows, you know, he's one of the 12, but he writes it down, and if you had been exposed to that, you're thinking, wow, look, if this is what was in the sky, it means this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and to a Gentile, all those things are consistent because we've got the conjunction, we've got Jupiter, we've got Regulus, we've got Orion, we've got all this stuff. So when Paul says, yeah, they did know. Okay. I don't believe personally that what Paul is referring to is like, y'all know who D. James Kennedy is? Familiar name? D. James Kennedy believed that you could get the whole plan of salvation out of the constellations of the zodiac. I think that goes too far. I don't believe that. But what I do believe that you could know is that a divine king had been born. I think that is what Paul's tracking on. Again, I can't prove that specifically. There's no verse, there's no footnote in Romans 10:18 that says, go look at Revelation 12. Because Revelation 12 wasn't written yet, so we can't quote it. But I think that's what he's tracking on. But if the point is for the book here, if you had that stuff in your head, somebody born on that day, who turns out to be this Jesus of Nazareth, who's walking around doing all sorts of miracles and saying, like, I'm the guy. Okay, that would have meant something to you. Okay, that would have meant this is the guy who is going to somehow reverse the effects of the wickedness of the world. Okay? It's not a terribly deep thought, but to sort of track with it the way they would have tracked it, you know, is a different story. The genealogy, in a nutshell. Why are the four women in the genealogy there? They may or may not all be Gentiles. Probably at least one of them, one or two. Some people argue all four of them are. And it's really not important if they're Gentiles. But why are they the ones included? Quote here from... her name is Amy Richter. This is from her dissertation. She says, while the inclusion of women in biblical genealogies isn't unusual in itself... There are 14 such women in other genealogies, namely 1 Chronicles 2. The inclusion of these four women is all the more odd. You know, who are they? Rahab. Anybody name them? You got Rahab, Ruth. See the neglected, the Bathsheba, and Judah and Tamar. Okay, so. The quote here is like, if you'd think if you were going to put in four important women, you'd pick Sarah, Rebecca, okay, Rachel. I mean, major figures in the Torah, but they're not in. They don't get in. The four that do are sort of just kind of a mystery. Again, short version of this is that what Richter does in her dissertation, it's pretty recent. She did it at Marquette, which is a school that's becoming known for Second Temple studies. Her argument is that the reason these four women are in the genealogy is that there is something in their story, either something they did or something done to them, that has something to do with sexual transgression and the vocabulary used to describe the person and these events borrows vocabulary from Genesis 6. And so Richter argues that can't be a coincidence. And her argument is these four women are in here because they're four women who have scandalous history.